1400 hours. Jacket cells dosed with 20 nanogram of a drug we suspect causes cell arrest and eventual death within 72 hours. We're going in at 24 hours post-administration of the drug to check if there are any signs that the cells are being affected by the drug. Which cell viability assay are we going to use? Well, it all depends. Identifying the best cell health assay method to suit your needs requires an understanding of what each assay is measuring as a marker, how the measurement correlates with cell viability, and what are the limitations of the assay chemistries. In general, the assay methods available include the use of different classes of colorimetric tetrazolium reagents, resorufin reduction, and protease substrates generating a fluorescent signal, or the luminogenic ATP assay, and even a novel real-time assay. Keep in mind that your choice of assay may be dictated by the availability of instrumentation. For instance, if you only have an instrument that detects absorbance, then you may pick one that where the readout is absorbance. But if you have an instrument that can detect fluorescence, then you may go for that. And fluorescence tends to give you higher sensitivity, or even luminescence, which would be even more sensitive. So if you have an equipment that can detect that kind of readout, then you may opt for that kind of assay. I'll aim to give broad overviews of the categories of assays and what the technology is that you're utilizing, rather than specific pathway details. So feel free, once you kind of grasp the general big picture, then you can go ahead and look at the specific details for any given assay that you're considering. There are dye exclusion or rejection or avoidance tests such as Trypan Blue. There are also Congo Red and Erythrocin B, which are dye exclusion based tests. Then there are color intensity based, what is referred to as colorimetric assay, in the sense that you're measuring color intensity. And these include tests like MTT and variations of the MTT called MTS, XTT, and this is to do with the solubility, as we'll be discussing in a second, WSD, LDH, which is lactate dehydrogenase, SRB, NRU, and crystal violet, and these are colorimetric assays. There are also assays that are based on molecules that have fluorescence capabilities, so fluorometric assays, and some of these on the market include Propidium Iodide, 6FAFC, CFDAAM, and a more ubiquitous one, Alamar Blue. And with Alamar Blue, that's the trade name, but the compound is actually resorufin, which gets reduced to resorufin. And so that's a type of assay that is fluorescence based and looks at the metabolism of viable cells. Finally, there are assays that rely on luminescent molecules, and so you have ones that are ATP based, and then there are also real-time assays. Dyes that are excluded from live cells but can enter and stain cells that are dead because their membranes are permeable are available, and the conventional dye is Trypan Blue. These often require manual counting of stained cells, and remember, when the cell is dead, it allows the dye to go in, but if the cell is alive, then it prevents. The cell membrane is intact, and so it doesn't let the dye go in, and so you're counting the cells that are blue, which means they are dead. These kinds of assays obviously can only be used as an endpoint measurement, meaning that it's when the cells, you're no longer going to be needing the cells because they could be toxic to cells. So if you stain the cells with these, then you're pretty much done with the cells. And so normally you just take a little aliquot of the cells and assess it. And the rest of the cells that you intend to keep in your experiment, you intend to keep going, are not stained with these dyes. Going with the idea of measuring cell viability, another readily available cell viability assay is one that's based on the range of this compound called Tetrazolium, and there are different versions of it, of this compound. But essentially, this compound is able to be used in detecting viable cells, because viable cells have these NADPH dependent enzymes that are able to reduce the Tetrazolium compound into what is called formazan, and this formazan is an insoluble compound that then has to be dissolved in DMSO, and the product is actually this purple color. And so the more viable cells you have, the more of this formazan product that gets produced by these NADPH dependent enzymes in a metabolically active cell. And this formazan, then if there are a lot of metabolically active cell, you get a lot more of it. And so when you dissolve it in DMSO, you get a lot more of a richer or a darker purple color. And in wells where you had less viable cells, you're going to have less of a color intensity. And once again, this is absorbance based, so when you get the, when you dissolve the product, then you're able to read the absorbance as, I think, between 500 to 600 nanometers. These Tetrazolium based compounds, one of it is called MTT, and the full name is super long, so that's the full name. And so this one's an insoluble form where you have to use DMSO to dissolve it. But there are soluble forms that are out there. There's MTS, XTT, and WST1 compounds, which are soluble, but it's based on the same principle of the viable or metabolically active cells reducing these compounds in order as a byproduct of respiration. And then as a result, you get this formazan production that is able to be used to correlate the number of viable cells. So now if we move away for absorbance-based measurement of cell viability and look at a higher sensitivity method, such as the use of resorufin, this is where the resorufin compound, which normally doesn't have intrinsic fluorescence, it's a dark blue colored compound, is used to measure cell viability. So only viable cells with active metabolism can reduce this resorufin into resorufin, which is pink and fluorescent. So after 1 to 4 hours of incubation of this resorufin with cells, the viable cells are able to convert the resorufin into resorufin, a pink fluorescent compound, and then you're able to quantify it using a microplate spectral photometer or a specific fluorometer. So because it's a fluorescent readout, it is more sensitive than using Tetrazolium assays. But keep in mind that if you are testing in a background where there's high intrinsic fluorescence, then it would not be that ideal. But in general, it offers an advantage over Tetrazolium. Other assays that can be taken advantage of is that, given that when cells die, there's a loss of membrane integrity, which will then allow chemicals or proteins to freely enter or exit the cell. So when we did the trypan blue, for instance, when the cell is dead, it allows the dye in. But it can also have a situation where proteins such as proteases can then more easily exit a cell. And so you can use an assay that takes advantage of this. So when a cell dies and loses membrane integrity, dead cell proteases are released. And so by using a substrate that is either luminogenic or fluorogenic, that is fluorescent or releases luminescence or displays luminescent characteristics, you can then measure the dead cell protease activity. Finally, an assay that relies on a luminescent signal, which means it has the greatest sensitivity, and this involves ATP. ATP can be used to measure cell viability, since only viable cells can synthesize ATP. So ATP can be measured using a reagent called cell-titer glow, luminescent cell viability assay. So that brings me to the end of this video. Don't forget to give it a thumbs up if it was helpful. In summary, there are assays that utilize dye exclusion principles. There are assays that utilize dead proteases. There are those that rely on the ability of metabolically active cells to reduce a substrate, and then there are those that are also that may rely on ATP, the release of ATP, and giving a luminescent signal. So that's a brush overview of it. It's quite long, so I'm going to leave it here, and you can go ahead and look at the specific details for any assay that you are running. Thank you for dropping by. God bless you.